Hello, and welcome. It's time for your favorite kind of video, the monthly news roundup, made especially for those who don't regularly keep up with the latest in the emulation world. In today's video, we've got several major updates, starting with the merger of Lime 3DS and Pablo MK7's fork. Azahar has finally had its official release, but it's already surrounded by controversy. There's also a new soft mod for the Xbox 360 that lets you unlock any model without even opening it. In addition, the Suyu project has officially shut down. RPCS3 saw a performance boost of up to 200% on Linux. They said the same improvement would come to Windows, but so far, nothing. Meanwhile, RPCS3 for Android has become RPCSX, bringing major improvements but also some drama involving one of the project's Discord admins. NetherSX2 is back, now under the name NetherSX2 Classics. Could this mean the continuation of PS2 emulators for Android? And speaking of the PS2, a new tool is in development to decompile games from the platform and convert them into native Windows titles. Shad PS4 now supports HDR and FSR, adding a whole new layer of visual quality. And for those who missed Vita3k on Android, there's still a version being updated, and I'll be showing it to you. If you want to buy original games while saving a lot, check out Instant Gaming, the digital store that sells games for various platforms, such as PC, PlayStation, Xbox, and Nintendo Switch. Get games of all genres with discounts of up to 95%. You'll also find a variety of gift cards and credits for other services. You can pay for your order through your credit card on a website with a 4.7 rating on Trustpilot. You're buying games directly from Instant Gaming, not from other retailers. If you encounter any issues, Instant Gaming offers 24/7 support. And this month, Instant Gaming is offering a great discount on the newly released Monster Hunter Wilds, with up to 51% off, ensuring the lowest historical price for the game. Check out the price comparison with Steam's pricing. What are you waiting for to save? Links in the description. Before we start the video, I'd like to ask anyone who can to support Mr. Purple financially. I'll leave his PayPal in the description. He recently had some issues at home and needs help from the community. For those who don't know him, he's always been active in the Android emulation scene, bringing optimizations and improvements to many emulators. More recently, he's worked on exclusive drivers for both Citron and Eden. If you've got anything to spare, or you appreciate his work, consider donating. Even just a dollar or your local currency helps. If you enjoy videos like this, don't forget to leave a like so it reaches more people and supports the channel's growth. And if this is your first time here, consider subscribing to stay updated on emulators and platforms of all kinds. Let's start with the Xbox 360, a bit off topic for the channel, but this is a cool update. Now, as long as your console is on a compatible firmware version, you can unlock it using just a modified game demo. The most common one is Rock Band. The method involves putting demo files on a USB stick, launching it from the Xbox 360 menu, and hitting start to trigger the exploit. It takes around 5 to 15 minutes and doesn't always work 100% of the time, but as the project advances, both the success rate and execution time are improving. Once activated, you get full access to the console's features, including homebrew and other apps, just like with RGH. The Xbox 360 is also getting another emulator, called Xenon, built from scratch in C. It's still in the very early stages, and the developer warns not to expect games or demos to run well yet. Still, if development continues steadily, this could become the best 360 emulator out there, especially considering Xenia has a very small team and hasn't seen major improvements for a while. One piece of news I was personally waiting for this year was the return of CEMU for Android. Last month, a new build was released with several new features and fixes, like the D-pad issue that plagued previous versions. There's been a decent performance boost, but big problems still remain, like crashes when switching tracks in Mario Kart 8 and other visual bugs that make some games unplayable. In Zelda, Breath of the Wild, performance jumped from around 15 FPS to 25 FPS, a nice step forward, but still far from ideal, especially compared to Yuzu forks that offer better stability and performance overall. Now on to a newer project, Shad PS4, which recently sparked controversy after removing PKG file installer support, something I've covered in another video, linked in the card. The latest version adds two major features, HDR support, which significantly improves color quality on compatible displays, and FSR, Fidelity FX Super Resolution, which upscales lower resolutions and enhances the visual experience in most games. If you're struggling to install PKG files, we've got a build on our Discord that allows normal game installations. As promising projects emerge, like Azahar, Xenon, and Eden, others reach their end. In this case, Suyu is shutting down for good. According to the team, there are no longer developers willing to maintain the project, and hosting costs have become unsustainable. A notice was posted inviting anyone interested in keeping the site and web services running to reach out, otherwise everything will be taken offline when the next billing cycle hits. Interestingly, the developer still recommends users switch to Citron. But given everything that's happened with Citron lately, is that really a valid recommendation? Speaking of Citron, although this hasn't been publicly announced, the project seems to be struggling. They had said the switch verification requirement would be removed, but it's been over a month and no new version has been posted. For context, the project lost most of its reputation after banning nearly 16,000 users from their Discord for not verifying with an unlocked switch. To make matters worse, Camille, former Citron dev and now leading Eden, exposed the abuse he faced from Zephron after gaining recognition in the project. With a small number of devs still working on Citron, do you think the project can be saved? Let me know in the comments. After a long period with few major optimizations, RPCS3 recently showed benchmark improvements of up to 200% thanks to a new function called LTO. But don't rush to update just yet, the improvement is only available on Linux for now. The team said they plan to bring it to Windows, where most users are. In the tests, Ninja Gaiden jumped from 172 to 204 FPS, 18.6% increase, and Red Dead Redemption went from 17 to 25 FPS, nearly 40%. While not the full 200%, it's still a major step forward. Now we wait to see when it'll arrive on Windows. Still on RPCS3, now it's Android version, there's been another big change. The project merged with others and became RPCSX. But before we dive in, it's worth mentioning some drama involving a Discord mod named Heradox. I received multiple screenshots from users in our group reporting abusive behavior. While the images are concerning, I can't say with 100% certainty that he's being abusive, but the complaints have been frequent. Regarding the project, which is our main focus here, the emulator that previously only ran in a minimally decent way on devices with Snapdragon Gen 3 can now already run lighter games on devices with Snapdragon Gen 1, which is the same hardware as my phone. By next week, I intend to run some tests with a bundle of games on my device and share the results with you. What I can already say is that the performance has improved significantly after this merger. Another successful merger was the one that gave us Azahar, now considered the definitive Nintendo 3DS emulator. I already made a full review on the channel, you can check it out in the card. For those who don't know, Azahar was created by merging Lime 3DS and Pablo MK7's fork. He was one of Citrus key devs before Nintendo shut it down. The merger brought good performance gains but also controversy. The devs decided not to support .3DS files anymore, arguing the format was tied too closely to piracy. In theory, changing the file extension would work, but in practice, not so much. Some people had to re-download their games, and others with fan-translated titles or mods couldn't run them at all, even after using the recommended conversion tools. That's when a new group proposed a solution, Azahar Plus, a fork that brought back removed features like .3DS support and better .cie compatibility. In my opinion, this makes sense, especially since the 3DS is now basically abandonware. Nintendo no longer sells games for the platform, online services are gone, and there's no legal way to buy games anymore. However, the Azahar team didn't like the move and demanded that Azahar Plus change its name, claiming they didn't want Azahar associated with piracy. The debate escalated, with DMCA threats being thrown around. According to Alex Index in our Discord, the name Azahar isn't a registered trademark and therefore isn't exclusive property of the original project. I tend to agree, considering examples like Citra MMJ and Dolphin MMJR, which are performance-hacked forks of the originals and never had issues with their names. Both simply indicate that they are versions with performance hacks or additional features. But I want to know what you think, is the Azahar team right in demanding a name change for the fork? As of the time of writing this script, the Azahar Plus team hasn't changed the name, and I imagine they won't either. Another fork that recently appeared is Cytrus, developed by Jared, who also created Sadachi and Folium. Although this is still one of the first builds, in my tests it had the worst performance of all 3DS emulators. That doesn't mean it's a bad fork, it can still keep all games above 60 FPS. But if you're using a weaker PC or Android device, another option may be better. I'll keep you posted on any major updates. Now, back to PlayStation 2, NetherSX2 just got a new version. If you tried the last few builds on Android, you'll know it wasn't doing great, with graphical and performance issues in many games. I ran some tests myself and had difficulties with games like Ace Combat 4, Baldur's Gate Dark Alliance 2, Juice 2 Hot Import Nights, among others I was playing on my Android. This new version brings improvements like retro achievements support in hardcore mode. The GameDB was rebuilt based on version 3668 of EtherSX2, and other fixes that had already been implemented previously in NetherSX2 were also maintained. The controller DB was updated, which means compatible controllers should now be automatically recognized without the need to configure each button manually. Additionally, the widescreen and no interlacing patches were updated to their latest versions. However, the developer himself states that the emulator is still in the alpha stage, meaning bugs and other issues may still occur. This is another project I plan to test for a week with different games to bring comparisons and show whether there have been significant improvements. So stay tuned for the next videos. Still talking about PlayStation 2, there's an ongoing effort to decompile and recompile games from the platform, just like we've seen with the Xbox 360 and Nintendo 64, with the goal of porting major classics from Sony's second console directly to PC. The project you're seeing in the background of the video is one of the first to do this and is called OpenGL. You can find it on my links page if you're interested. This project has already brought us Jak and Daxter 1 and 2 as native PC ports, and the third game, often considered the best in the franchise, is currently in development. With the right documentation, it's possible that other classics like God of War and Gran Turismo could also receive native versions for PC, Android, or even other platforms, removing the need for emulation altogether. Lastly, I get weekly questions about the status of Vita3k on Android. Until recently, the last version was V12, with some fixes, but still many issues. I had trouble running certain games in Vulkan with custom drivers on my Snapdragon device. The app is now at version 12.5 build 3. I haven't tested it yet but plan to soon. The changelog shows that many Windows features have made it to Android, and new Android-specific functions are being added too. However, updates are still not frequent, usually taking between 2 to 3 months for a new version, something similar to what happens with CEMU for Android. But for those who are waiting for updates, you can now download and test the new versions of Vita3k. All download links for the projects mentioned will be available on my Patreon page. All posts are free. No subscription is required to access them. Just a reminder, games are the user's responsibility and will not be provided. If you like the content and want to support the channel, consider subscribing to the Patreon. But it's totally optional. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next video.